Hello, everyone. Welcome to Third Wednesday Bible Study. Hopefully, everyone is having a fantastic week. It is good to see everyone. We're going to jump into the message. We talked last Wednesday, the first Wednesday, we're getting into the spiritual gifts. I want to do a teaching on some of the spiritual gifts. And the first thing we need to acknowledge is the church. Who is the church? So we discussed that we are the church, amen, the ecclesia, that it's the assembling of the body of Christ is really what the church is, that we've misinterpreted within our English language, that we've taken the church as a building, as an establishment, but it's really not. It's an ecclesia, the assembly together of the body of Christ. So we had to realize who the church really is before we could really understand the gifts, that the building can't teach, right? The building can't heal. The building can't prophesy. I mean, if it did, we'd all be standing outside of the building and waiting for the windows to speak to us or falling on the concrete to get healed. But it does. We are the church. We are the ecclesia. And we have to understand that. And the gifts flow through us. Amen. So the ministry gifts are not just for the church. They are for all of our lives in every area of our life. They are to be used in our homes, at workplaces, and everywhere else we go. They should become a lifestyle. Amen? Because we are going everywhere. We go to the grocery store. We go to the hardware store. We go to schools. We go to work. So we are the assembly. We are the church. We are a movement, right? And we talked about this before, that we are a movement, not an establishment. And we can see some of the gifts. The specific gifts that Paul references in some of the key passages, 1 Corinthians 12, we can see that through 8 through 10 and 28, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, healing, prophecy, in prophets, tongues, interpretation of tongues, apostles, teachers, deeds of power, forms of assistance, forms of leadership. You can see within Romans 12, 6 through 8, prophecy, ministry, teaching, exhortation, giving, leading, showing mercy. And within Ephesians 4:11, you can see apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, even the gift of giving, gift of serving. There's all types of gifts. And so I want us to jump into those gifts, and I want us to realize what those gifts are. And if you haven't done a spiritual assessment of maybe where you lean within gifts, you can pick up one of the Growth Track books, and the Growth Track has the spiritual testing, where you can take spiritual testing, and you can do that at home, and it kind of gives you an idea of where you might rank highly, whether you're in administration, or whether you're in the gift of giving, or serving, or teaching, or exhortation. So you can pick up one of the books and do the testing on your own if you want. And it kind of gives you a brief description over a lot of the different areas that you might fall into. But I want us to understand that several key terms are linked to the concept of spiritual gifts. And within the Greek, we get the word charisma is generally translated as gift. But because it is likely derived from charis, which means grace, the term may be better translated concrete expression of grace or gracious bestowment. And the reason why I want us to understand that is because the gifts of the Spirit is exactly that. It is a gift from one Spirit, the Spirit of God, through Holy Spirit. It's only by Holy Spirit that the gifts can be activated. It's only through Holy Spirit that the gifts can be given. And he's given it freely as his will. It says in Hebrews 2:4, God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. So the gifts are through Holy Spirit. Amen. And Holy Spirit and God is one. Holy, you can't have one without the other. And I love, and it's just a confirmation that a book that I was in the middle of reading a book, a really good book on God himself, and it just opens up the scripture and everything that I've studied, and from the beginning, God, the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit, existed. There was none that existed without the other. They existed. We can read that from the beginning of time. And it's through the Spirit is how God bestows his gifts, how he, let's just say, equips and installs, amen, how he utilizes us, and how we know the nature of God is through Holy Spirit, because Holy Spirit is God. Holy Spirit is the nature of God. There is no difference between Jesus, the Son, the Father, and Holy Spirit. And this is how we have this knowledge of God and the indwelling of God is through the Holy Spirit. And where I want us to go today is there's three things that we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about prophet, and we're going to talk about teacher, and we're going to talk about a server. And we'll see how many we get through these. And then next Wednesday teaching, we're going to hit on a couple more. But the most important thing that we need to realize is it's through one Spirit. So that means the prophet, the teacher, the server, the giver, they're not enacting in any other way but through Holy Spirit, right? So there is no confusion. There is no a problem, or there's no disagreement. There'll be no struggle. There's not going to be I thought the Father was doing this. I thought the Son was doing this. I thought God was doing this. No, it's through one Spirit. Amen. It's through one Spirit. That's the most important thing that we have to realize and understand, that it's according to how Holy Spirit, how our Father wants to will to give those gifts. You might have a gift of prophecy, and then you might have a gift of teaching. He might use you one time for a gift of healing. You might have the gift of healing at all times. Amen. That doesn't mean we can't speak life at all times. That doesn't mean we still don't lay hands on an individual. Well, I don't know if I have the gift of healing. Well, you know what? Still lay hands on the individual. You know, you are the ecclesia. You are the church. You are the movement. You are filled and empowered by Holy Spirit. But let's talk about prophecy. Prophet is a prophecy ability. The ability to deliver representative declarations of the mind, will, or knowledge of God. And you have to align the prophets to make sure you don't have a prophet liar, right? Because there's people out there that will prophet lie. It's not of God. And this is where there's a difference that we have to really understand is too many times we as individuals, we want to seek out a sorcerer, amen? We want to seek out a fortune teller. And we have to understand the differences. Right? We're going to get into a little bit of that, because we're going to dive into the prophet, and then I might even bring some more information that's really, really valuable within this. But we have to realize that when you go to like a fortune teller or a palm reader or an oversized light bulb reader, because that's basically, right? It's just an oversized light bulb that, this is what it's telling me. If the light bulb's giving my future, then you know what? I don't know what wattage it is, but eventually it's going to go out. Amen? So I can't trust that. But if you've noticed, you end up paying those individuals, right? And they get paid by how they can encourage you or what they can give you, right? Because it's about you. See, a prophet, it's not about an individual. It's about God's will and his knowledge. Because there's things that could be prophesied that are a little bit uncomfortable, amen? And you can't pay for God's wisdom. You can't pay for God's knowledge. Just think of the individual that wanted to hand some of the apostles some money. I mean, they were trying to buy Holy Spirit. We know what cursed are you, man? Let me tell you, you can't buy Holy Spirit. You can't buy salvation. You can't buy the wisdom of God. You cannot buy his signs and wonders. You can't, Holy Spirit's not for sale. First of all, Holy Spirit's a free gift through Jesus Christ, amen? And it's only by Holy Spirit that you come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So a prophet is going to speak on behalf of God. God's will, not your will. What God wants you to hear, not what you want to hear. Right? We have to be real about it, because a lot of times we have to understand that there's no gray area with the prophet. That's the gift of prophecy. is there's no gray area. It's black or white. This is what God said. And there's things that as we go through these, I'm going to bring back around, because I'm going to bring some things within some of the gifts that are good and positive, but then also some things that you need to be aware of, that if you fall in the gift of prophecy, that you're not, over-exercising the gift, that there's some abuses. There's some things that can be abused by the gift. There's some things that we could fall into. We can start utilizing the gift of prophecy for a way to make money. Amen. A way to, if I just come in and I prophesy to everyone that, you are going to have a future. You are going to be blessed. Well, that's nothing. Tell me something new. Because Jeremiah 29:11 says that God has blessings for me, right? He knows my future. He knows my hope. But see, we have to understand that prophets, since there is no gray area and it's black and white, they're very good at calling out sin, right? But we don't like that from prophets, do we? But how many prophets are calling out sin within the kings? How many prophets, they're receiving visions that, just let you know, your kingship's going to be ending probably here, or you're going to be a ruler, for the next 8 years, or there's going to be a famine from here. But they're hearing from God. And everything that they speak is according to God. There's no gray areas. It's either this is what the Lord says, and this is not what the Lord says. It's either you are in the midst of sin. Look at John the Baptist. He was a prophet, was he not? He was the forerunner. He was the best one he was giving good hope. It didn't sound like it, did it? Repent, for the kingdom of God is near. But let me tell you, there's one coming that I'm not even worthy to tie his shoelaces. He's the living God. He's the salvation. He is the way and the only way. But see, some of them are like, oh yeah, hallelujah. And some of them took it kind of like, what are you talking about? So you can take it as a personal conviction, or you can take it as condemnation. If you take anything as condemnation that is from the word, from the Lord, well, then that's your pride and your ego getting in the way. Right? Because whenever the prophet speaks a word of God, it will only be conviction. If you turn that conviction into condemnation, then it's all about you. It's not about God. And you'll take and you'll make his word null and void in the midst of it. You will not receive it. You will not digest it. You will not take it. Prophets can only speak God's word whether you like it or not. And you have to realize that. And you can align the prophets up with the word of God. Does that line up? There's been prophets that's been spoken over my wife and I's lives that, I don't know of a time that I had a prophet come and speak that it wasn't confirmation already that was in my spirit. As soon as a prophet comes and speaks something over my life or into my life that I have not already heard or felt from God in the midst of prayer or in the midst of my relationship with God, then I have to really, I have to take that and I have to submit that to God, and I have to pray over that. God, this is what the individual is saying. I'm choosing not to receive it until I hear a confirmation from you. Because you have to be very careful what you receive in the spirit, within the spirit realm. Because not everything that's spoken to you is going to be from God. So we have to align it. The other thing that prophets do is they preach hellfire messages, right? That's what a prophet does. John the Baptist, man, he was a hellfire preacher, amen? Let me just tell you, you need to repent. You need to repent. How many times did he tell the king? All the way to when he was beheaded. See, it might cost you something to be a prophet, right? See, I also read that somewhere within a prophet is they look odd. They're kind of kind of different, and they're viewed differently, and I'm thinking, well, I really don't like that terminology, because the way I look at it is a true prophet is actually getting closer to God, where it's more about God than anything else. So the closer you get to God, the more stranger you're going to look to the world. So if I'm taking a man of God or a woman of God that is called as a prophet and I'm thinking that they're strange, then I really need to look at myself and say, maybe I have more of the world in me than I actually do God. Because the closer I get to God, the less the world is going to like me and the less of the world I'm going to look like. Because whenever Moses met with God Almighty, that he put a veil over it because, you know, the Shekinah glory, because I was in the presence of God Almighty. I was face to face. And see, as a prophet, you have to understand that as a prophet, their prayer life is a major part of being a prophet, because you're on your knees listening to God. And you're on your knees listening instead of speaking to God. How many times Daniel, he was waiting, he was praying, he was waiting for that answer. Do you think in the midst of prayer, if he was just constantly speaking and constantly talking, that he would even hear from God? See, they have an ear that's attuned to God's voice. That's what a prophet is. They're getting away. The reason why they look strange to the world is because you don't see much of them, because they're in their prayer closet. They're on their knees. They're seeking. They're listening. Their ears are in tune. And let me just tell you, you can have ears that hear God. I mean, I've had those ears. And I have those ears. Because I know as a child I heard God, and I know as growing up, but there were some times in my life that I went the other way besides what God said, and he became silent. And in the midst of that silence, the only way I was able to bring his voice back was in the midst of his word. And so when I want to hear God, I need to get in the midst of his word, and then I need to get on my knees in my prayer closet, and then I just need to be silent and listen to him. That's the reason why so many times I get fed by reading the word, is how I listen to his voice, because he speaks through this. He still speaks audible, but it's not like it used to be. Since I caused the problem, now there's a little extra work. Amen? And it's okay, because eventually that little extra work's gonna go away the closer I get to him. But a prophet will preach hellfire messages. Amen? There's nothing wrong with the hellfire message. But society today puts a stiff arm to those messages. That's why we had a message about hell, because how many churches you really hear teach on hell? But hell's real, right? But do we understand what we're saved from? If we don't understand what hell is, then we'll never understand what we're saved from. And if we don't understand what we're saved from, then salvation's really a token. It's really nothing. It's not really priceless. It's not really a gift. It's just a hearsay. That's why there's a lot of motivational speakers, but there's not a lot of pastors. 1 Corinthians 14:3 says, but he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. It goes right back to a prophet. If you're really willing to receive the word of God through a man or a woman, it's going to be edification, it's going to be encouragement, right? Yeah. You know, that king had that opportunity to listen to John the Baptist. There was something with the spirit that he knew he was different. But if he would just take it as encouragement, as edification, that, you know what, maybe there's something about John that he's saying that is real. Maybe there's something, and a lot of times when we're in the midst of sin, we don't really want to hear about it, because we're trying to justify it. We have an excuse for it. So we stiff arm it. And the king was stiff arming it, you know, because he knew John the Baptist was right. There is something about John the Baptist that is right, but let me just stiff arm him, because I don't really want to hear it, because now I might have to change. Now I might have to take actions and be accountable for it. So, what a prophet does, declares the mind of God, the will of God, the knowledge of God. He speaks the word of God. Daniel spoke the word of God. What does the vision say? Well, let me just tell you, King, this is what the vision says. None of the sorcerers, none of the magicians, none of those guys could figure it out, to the point where the king was going to, let me just go ahead, we're going to kill everyone here if they can't tell me what the dream is. Can you imagine, you know what, a king coming up to you and say, look, you know what, here's the deal. I need an interpretation of my dream. Okay, tell me the dream. No, 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 no. I want you to tell me what the dream is so I know that you're not faking it. And if you can't, then I'm going to go ahead and kill you. That's pretty difficult to swallow, isn't it? That's. But Daniel's like, you know what, I can't. You know, and I love the fact that the prophet always gives God the glory. A true prophet will never, ever take the glory. Anytime that you have an individual that wants to speak a word and take the glory for it, that's not a prophet. That's a prophet liar. Because he's wanting the glory. You might be looking at Satan himself, because that's exactly what Satan wants to do. Satan wants to give a word, but he wants to take the glory from God. That's why he'll miscue and corrupt God's word. He's a prophet liar. A prophet will speak God's word and stand on God's word, whether it means be beheaded, thrown in the lion's den, thrown in the furnace, having to run. They stand for God's word. They speak God's word. They have a relationship with God. A true prophet will have a relationship with God where he knows God has spoken this to him. We can see this. Isaiah went naked and barefoot for 3 years. You can read it in Isaiah 20, verses 2 through 3. Isaiah did. Went naked and barefoot. They take it very seriously, don't they? Ezekiel laid on his side 390 days. And on his right side, on his left side, he laid 390 days. And on his right side for 40 more days. Ezekiel 4, 1 through 8, verses 1 through 8. You can see this. Daniel was in the midst of prayer. And see, a prophet will only bow down to God. We see that within the Bible. See, a prophet's just not only good news. It's going to call out your sin. It's going to call out corruption. You know, King, you're in the midst of sin. You need to clean this out of your house. You know what? How about the prophet that came to Hezekiah and says, you know what? Get your house in order because God's going to take you. He turns around and walks off. God calls him back. Okay, you know what? The guy got his house in order. Go back, tell him he has 15 more years. Hey, God, God heard you. Just let you know you have 15 more years. See how they hear? Their ears are attuned. If you feel like you have a gift of prophecy, you should have a gift of praying and listening. If you don't have a gift of listening, then you're probably not a prophet. Amen? And you know if you're a listener or not. Also, a prophet submits himself. If you're not a one that can submit yourself to leadership, then you're probably not a prophet. If you're the one that has to be the leader, you have to be the one that runs and reigns and rules, then you're probably not a prophet because you have to submit to God and his authority. We know what happens, right? I need you to go to a place and I need you to talk to him, right? But Jonah ran, right? But he ended up going anyway, didn't he? See, a prophet will submit to leadership, to authority, to God. That's one thing that prophets have a problem with, listening to so many other people, because they're so in tune with God that they tune out. That's one of the weaknesses. A lot of times they tune out others because they're so in tune with God. That's why they love to live by themselves. You see a lot of prophets that they're by themselves. It's God. What else do you really need? I'm so satisfied with God. I have a relationship with God that what else do I really need, right? Daniel had a relationship with God that, you know, I'll just pray and fast and I'll wait for God to show up and show off. I'll wait for the answer. And you know what? If the answer is that, you know, I have to, you know what, go to the lion's den, then that's fine. If that means I have to submit to someone else or to the God, I'm not going to do that. How many of us could really be a prophet if someone came in through those doors, put a gun to our head, and say you're going to bow down to someone else, or you're going to declare that Jesus is not Lord and Savior. If you don't do that, then I'm going to kill you. How many could? Three individuals are thrown in the furnace. Elijah facing 300 to 400 prophets of Baal, but then he ran from a Jezebel spirit. That I don't understand. But then again, I have to look at my own weaknesses too. I can stand up for a lot of things, and then a little cockroach or a spider comes and, right? I'll run from a little snake that's underneath the garbage can. Alma, you got to go take the garbage up, honey. Why, what's out there? Nothing. Don't worry about it. Right? I mean, we all have those issues. But we see the prophets are in tune, and they only speak God's word. What's on his mind, his will, and his knowledge. That's a prophet. A prophet's not always to bring good news. A prophet's not a fortune teller, a palm reader. It's not always about you. It's only about God. Amen? And that's what we have to understand. And this is where we miss true prophecy. And this is where we ignore the prophets that God has raised up and raising up to this day, is because if it doesn't involve me and me getting something out of it, then I really don't want to accept it. I don't want to hear it. And I'm not going to acknowledge it. But see, a true prophet is edification and exhortation and comfort to men. So whenever I choose to listen to a prophet that comes along and says that Jesus is the way, repent, for Jesus is the way, then I don't know about you, but that's edification. That, you know what, I just learned that Jesus is the way. I just learned that there's good news. I just learned that I have salvation in him. Now, you know what, there's an exhortation about that, you know, I'm going to be saved and set apart because of Jesus Christ. And that brings a comfort to me as well. Because when a prophet speaks and we receive the word of God, then there's going to be a comfort. Amen? That means it's not going to be a condemnation. It's going to be an encouraging word that, you know what, I see your sin, but I sent my son to die on the cross that you can be saved through him. I need you to repent. I'm not closing the door. I love you unconditionally. I need you to just repent and turn from your ways and receive me. And so what do we have? We have edification, encouragement, and comfort. That's what it brings. I love the fact that Holy Spirit came to me and said, you know, you're a sinner and you're going to go to hell. And I'm glad I received it. Because what he said is, you know what, you're a sinner and you're going to go to hell. This is what you're going to do. But let me just share with you Jesus. Our Father gave his only begotten Son, that he loves you, that he chooses not for you to go to hell, that he made a way. I don't know about you, but that was great. Fell on my knees, received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, turned from so many ways. That it doesn't mean it has been a trip through the rose petals and through chocolate, dark chocolate candies. No, it's been through hell and it's been through heaven. It's been through difficult times and it's been through good times. But there's just something that I know that I'm saved and set apart. There's a comfort. There's a peace that you know what? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil because my shepherd, my comforter, my buckler, my shield is with me and I shall not want. There's just something about it. That's a little bit on the prophet. We're going to get in some more. I want to touch on the teacher because I want to definitely get to the teacher because I know that we are all called as teachers. And I know some of you are probably sitting there thinking, well, I'm not called as a teacher. But we think in a worldly aspect that, you know what, a teacher, I'm not going to go and teach school. Those kids are too wild. You know, I'm not going to be a pastor or a teacher at a church, but I want you to understand that a teacher is one that impart skills or knowledge to. Okay? And I'm going to skip down. I have a couple verses before this, but I want you to read the Shema, Deuteronomy. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall what? You shall what? Them diligently to where? and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. So each and every one of us really has the gift of teaching, right? We are all teachers. I mean, God made it very clear to Moses and to all the, you know what, this is the reason why we celebrate Passover, so we could teach our kids that, you know what, once your daddy was bound to hell, but because Jesus, he is saved and set apart. Because of God, the grace of God, I am saved. So we can teach these, right? We can teach these that, you know, obedience brings the blessing. Amen. Obedience brings the blessing. Disobedience brings cursing. And I don't know about you, but I don't want cursing. Going and seeking other idols and opening doors creates other gods and creates idolatry and all kinds of other sins. Amen? And then whenever I teach that, you know what, I realize that, you know, I can't, you know, just take that these commandments are really bad and I can tell one little lie or I can do this, because whenever I teach these to my children, that if you commit one, you've done them all. Jesus even made it clear, because, see, they were trying to justify that since I'm not sleeping with this lady, that means I'm not in the midst of adultery. And Jesus came all the way around. I love how he did it. Yeah, you might not be physically in the act, but let me clear up something so you know that they're not the ones that's going to go to hell and you're just going to go to heaven and you're okay with your sin. Let me just tell you, if you think upon a woman and lust upon a woman the wrong way, you've already done it. So you're no different than them. So I need you to love your neighbor. I need you to stop judging. We can teach this, right? We can also teach and do our part that, you know what, there's only one race. You know, black isn't a race, white isn't a race, Hispanic isn't a race, Chinese isn't a race, Japanese isn't a race, Germany is not a race, Italy is not a race. There's one race, and it's called the human race. And then we can teach that we can stand up for it, and that we're not going to allow that in our home. We're not going to allow that in our neighborhoods. We're going to pray. You know, we can also teach that, you know what, God created each of us completely unique, different than everyone else. So two white people standing up here, two black people standing up here, two Hispanics standing up here, two Japanese up here, they're not the same color. They might look like it to the eyes, but you know what? Whenever you dive in, their DNA is completely different. Their skin pigment's different. Their fingerprints are completely different. Even identical twins have different fingerprints, different DNA. So no one's the same. We can teach that. We can teach that hate is not an option. God is love. God cannot be any otherwise. He cannot be a father without a son. That's the reason why the son had to be, is in the same existence in Holy Spirit as the father. There's not the time that father came, then the son came, the Holy Spirit came. They all existed all at one time. That's deity. God is able. God's all things. We can teach this. We can teach that we can stand. We don't have to be bullied. We can stand for the word of God. We don't live by sight. No matter how the nation looks, no matter what's coming, no matter what's going to come, let me just tell you, even when the death angel comes knocking and it's our time to go, we do not have to fear death. We can teach that because we're saved and set apart, we'll never be separated from God. We can teach that. What if we were diligent on teaching? We'd have less fear, right? We'd have more people standing for God. We would be comforted and encouraged that we have a mansion in heaven, right? That Jesus went and prepared a way. The more I talk about Jesus, the more it grows my faith, right? The more I walk through things, it should be growing my faith. Why do you think God allows things? Because, you know, we have to grow our faith, right? And see, the thing is we're too busy. We have this, and we'll do it on our own. I don't remember God ever sending out one disciple by himself. Maybe I'm wrong, right? But isn't the true church the assembly of ourselves? Isn't that where there's strength? That when I'm weak and I feel like, man, this is the day that nothing's going to happen right, you can correct me. In love? No, you know what? You can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. No, you are smart. You are able to. No, let me just tell you, God has prepared a way and made a way. Isn't this what we should be teaching? Isn't this what we should be teaching, that Jesus is the only way? There is no other way? So we're all teachers, right? So we should all be imparting skills or knowledge to someone, right? So we're all teachers. And that means if we're a teacher, to be a true teacher, that means we really need to know the word, right? That means it kind of goes back to what 2 Timothy 2:15 says, but be diligent to present yourself approved to God. Well, how do I do that? A worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Have you ever been asked a question about the Bible and you felt ashamed? And the shame comes from because you had an opportunity to study it, but you chose not to. It doesn't come from, knowing all about God, because we'll never all know about God. His thoughts are greater than our thoughts. But the shame comes where, I wish I would have known John 3:16. I wish I even opened the Bible, right? I wish I could have at least, stayed awake when the pastor talked about that. So I would just could have regurgitated what he said, right? Sometimes that's how we feel shame, right? Because we don't study to show ourselves approved. We're not going to know it all. But when we can go and you know what? Oh, wow, that's a great question. You know what? Let me get the assembly together so we can dialogue about this. I'll get back with you. Because I think there's another brother or sister that, I would like to answer this, but, just let me get back with them. You'll know and you'll feel comfortable. Or we can do just like Daniel or the prophets. You know what? King, let me just tell you. I have a God that knows. Give me just a second. Give me some time. I'll come back to you next. Can I come back to you tomorrow? Because I'm going to spend all night in prayer and fasting seeking the answer, because I have a God that does know the answer, right? But to be a teacher, we need to study, right? How would you like to have an English teacher that never knows English? You wouldn't want me teaching English, because your kids would not know their ears and words and R's and what's, and it'd be redneck and everything else. I'm just telling you. Now, math, no, it might be a different subject. Programming might be a different subject. Science, I can blow up anything. I mean, hey, that's the fun part. Isn't that science? You just blow up something? I mean, I don't, sometimes I don't learn from it until after 10 or 15 times, but I have fun, right? So we have to study. We have to study. We have to read the word. And we come to him in spirit and truth, and we worship him in spirit and truth. And how we study is we take the word, whether we think we know it or not, and we go to God and say, Lord, teach me your word. As I read your word, Holy Spirit, bring the scripture alive. I do that all the time. Holy Spirit, I want you to bring this word right here that I'm reading is already written on my heart. And what I want you to do is, as I read this, I want you to illuminate this word and bring this word forth where it's an overflowing, where my mind understands it supernaturally, where I'm not even understanding it physically, where I only understand it spiritually. And that's the biggest problem I have is spiritually, I have a problem getting out some of the things spiritually into a physically area or into a word area that I can't even describe. That's what I'm trying to work on, is spiritually. Oh, man, but I've got to try to get it out. Or you'll just send me down the road and put me in a mental ward if I don't, because spiritually, God is just so incredible. Because this is a spiritual book. This is all spiritual. Why do you think we want to skip Revelation when we start talking about, man, that thing has how many horns and how many eyes? Because we can't physically wrap our head around it. But it's not supposed to be in a physical. It's a spiritual. It's a spiritual meaning behind everything. Because what's one thing that we don't fight against? Flesh and blood. You know why? Because flesh and blood's going to return right back to the dust. Because it's meaningless. You know what's going to survive is our spirit. That's why we're going to get a new body. Because the physical, in the physical nature, we've sinned. Right? Well, that's a whole different message there. says in Exodus 18:20, and you shall teach them the statutes and the laws and show them the way in which they must walk and the work they must do. You know, this is what God's telling Moses and Aaron, but then what did Moses and Aaron come and say? And a lot of these, you know, things, you know, I'm glad this is written, but you know how many things? This is why you need to get the Mishnah, or which is the oracle, the oral parts of the law, because, you know, they didn't have, you know, like what we have is a pen and paper, right? So a lot of theirs was, you know, I need you to get together and I need you to share this because I need you to make sure that, you know, your son knows this. Why do you think in the Jewish culture that, and I get this because within the Torah classes that I've taught and the Jewish cultures that I read and I try to teach is repetitiveness is a necessity. You have to repeat it and repeat it and repeat it and repeat it because people get it after you repeat it, after you repeat it. Why do you think they say that if you want to memorize something, you need to repeat it to yourself 25 times before you can memorize it? And it's really true. Whenever I take a Bible verse and I want to memorize it, I mark it down every time and I repeat it 25 times. And usually before 25 times, I haven't tried it lately. It might be 75 times now, but usually I can have it memorized by that time because it's being repetitive. And this is the reason why, you know what, we have to be repetitive. That, you know what, son, let me just tell you, you know, your daddy used to be a sinner. This is why, but Jesus Christ saved me because I need him to know that Jesus Christ is the only way. I need him to know that obedience brings the blessing. I need him to know that God is nothing but love. He cannot hate. I need him to know that God is all powerful. I need him to know that he can do all things through Christ that strengthens him because we live in the physical realm that is tearing us down each and every day, wanting to consume us each and every day. And if we're not feeding ourselves with the word of God, then we're going to be overtaken with the world instead of God's word. And that's why. And they didn't have the time to write down everything. So we had to speak it over and over. And I'm going to speak it until he memorizes it. I'm going to speak it until he knows it. I'm going to speak it until he walks out of the house knowing that, you know what, I'm a child of God. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. I can stand in the midst of the situation. Oh, I'm going to be beheaded? Bring it on. Because you can only behead me if God allows it. And if he allows it, then when I'm absent from this body, I'm present with the Lord. Hallelujah. That's why we need to study. That's why we need to speak it so we hear it and it grows our faith. Amen? And I'm just barely touching on some of these. I'm just touching. 42 minutes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Aren't you glad I have 10 pages? I only have two. I want to briefly touch on this, and I want to talk about a servant, because this is something that's part of my DNA, that's just been from day one growing up is I have a servant's heart to serve. I believe that, you know what, no matter where I'm at, no matter where God elevates me, no matter what title God places on me, you can never be above serving. I believe serving keeps you humble. I see this, that humility was the biggest thing the Bible really talks about, is humility, right? To humble ourselves. That if a God that was able to do whatever he wants, chooses to do whatever he wants, stepped off the throne to give up his life and to serve us, to wash our feet, I mean, to think that I'm above serving. That's the reason why our mission is building people, serving God. Because whenever I build you, we're going to serve God. Amen? Whenever we can teach you and exhort you and edify the word of God and you grow closer to God, that means, you know what? The closer you grow to God, the more you're going to want to serve. Because you're going to want to serve. What are you going to want to serve? You're going to serve his word. You're going to want to serve his teaching. You're going to serve each and every individual, the gospel. Amen? Whether I have to wash your feet in order for you to know Jesus Christ, hallelujah. I can wash my hands from those grungy toes. That's okay. There's disinfectant. Amen. Hallelujah. Some of you might have some fungi, but you know what? That's okay. If that's what God calls it, we need to humble ourselves, right? And serve. See, it says Matthew 4:10, but you'll never be a servant until you become a servant of God. And it says, then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God. In him only you shall what? Serve him only. well, then that means I don't serve anybody else. And no, because Jesus made it very clear that if you serve him, you serve others. How do I love others, and how do I show that love? And because Jesus loved us so much that he served up his own life on that cross. So he's a perfect example of servanthood. He came not to be served, but to serve. So if I'm picking up my cross and I'm following, that means, one, I'm serving God, and if I'm serving God, that means I'm serving my brothers and sisters out here. I'm serving love, right? I'm not serving hatred. I'm not serving judgment, right? I'm not serving a finger at them, because God's made it very clear to take a look at your own plank before you go do anything with their speck. He made it very clear, right? See, the serving-minded look for opportunities to assist others. See, doing for others is an important part of their lives. And maybe, you know what, you can identify. Maybe that's something that, man, when I serve, I just, you know what, servers, you know what, seem to always make work day at church. Right? Because it's part of their DNA. They serve their community. They serve their church. They want to make a difference, right? And see, one of the things with a servant's heart, you have to make sure that you're doing it for God, or else, you know what, frustration and burnout can come, right? And you also have to learn the most powerful word there is as a servant. No. Right? Can we have some music? You have to learn no. Because as a servant, wanting to serve others, it's easy to get so caught up that we start serving others and we stop serving God, right? There's a balance. God always comes first. And if I'm serving out of the right heart, then I'll never experience burnout. That's what people in the ministry, they've told me, you know. Working with them side by side, I wasn't even a pastor, but, you know, I just feel burned out. You know, I feel frustrated. Why are we doing this each and every day? Why am I waking up at 1 a.m? Well, let me ask you, who are you doing it for? Well, I'm doing it for them. Well, then you don't need to be here, because you're not doing it for God. Because, see, I'm doing it for God. Because, see, if I do it for man, I'm going to get frustrated. I'm going to get angry. I'm going to get PO'd, right? But if I do it for God, how can I be frustrated or PO'd at God? And I believe we all have that gift of serving, right? Because we all want to serve God, right? We have a spouse to serve. We have children to serve, right? So I believe serving is something that we all have, that DNA. And I believe that serving is something we need to cultivate. And when we serve, we need to check ourselves to make sure, who am I serving? Right? Because if you're serving, you know, I'm just going over and mowing my neighbor's yard and don't ever get anything for it. Well, yeah, the reason why you're not getting anything for it is because you're serving them. You're not doing it unto God, right? Because when I do it unto God, then you know what? That's the best looking yard. It goes by really fast. There's not no issues or problems, it seems like. You know, even if there is, it's all joy, amen? We have to speak sometimes to an existence, but as long as I'm doing it for God, I'll never have a burnout. I'll never be frustrated. Because as long as I'm serving God, that means, you know what? God's the one's telling me when, what, how. And then if he's in control, then I'm never going to experience a burnout, right? I'm never going to experience frustration, right? Because he's never going to lead me down that path. And I'll always be rewarded by him. Well done, faithful servant, right? Well done, faithful servant. Well done. What you've done to them, you've done unto me, right? That's how I've always thought about it. That's why I was able to wake up for a church for a couple years, 1 o'clock, get up in the morning at church between 1 and 3 a.m, doing load in, load out, and I didn't leave there probably till 6 p.m, sometimes 9 p.m, because right after that, I go and teach the Torah class, and sometimes I get home at 9, 9:30, 10 o'clock, and then I'm working a full-time job and working a full-time job at the church, and know, how do you do it? I don't have no idea how I do it. Well, aren't you burned out? Aren't you? No, because, you know, I'm not doing it for them. I'm doing it for God. But you're serving them. No, I'm serving God. God told me to do this. So as long as I do what God told me to do, he gives me the strength and the power and everything that, you know what, and turned out everything ends up working out for the good, that because God Almighty was getting the glory because I was serving him. Right? So your servant heart is the most important thing. What's your heart connected to when you serve? Is it to God or is it to what you're serving? Right? Because Jesus was serving his Father. He wasn't serving the disciples' feet, was he? It was pleasing to our Father. And when we serve for our Father, then you know what? We'll be more acceptable of going to the places that we normally wouldn't go to serve, right? We would do the things that we might not want to do. I served pastors, I served others. I was digging up sewer lines. I had crap all over me because the bathrooms had to work at the church, or the bathrooms needed to work at someone else's house. The ladder was broken, but the air conditioner still worked. The electrical still done. And you know what? To this day, I still do. Because I do it through God. Not for me, for the glory, but for God. But it makes a difference. Because I used to serve man. Because I wanted something from man. And I realized what I got from man was temporal. Because I needed to go back and serve him so I can get another attaboy. But whenever I realized that I need to serve God Almighty, I didn't need an attaboy because I had an unconditional love at all times and a peace and a comfort that only can come from him. I knew I was loved by him, no matter if they loved me or not. Because if you're serving a man, and whenever you serve and they don't like how you served, then you're going to come back disgruntled, and you're going to come back with no hope, and you're going to come back all broken. But when you know you served it and you did exactly what God would have done, you can lift your head up high and know that you are pleasing God Almighty, and you don't have to worry about what man says. Because I'm serving God, right? How many times you leave busted and broken thinking you're doing someone a favor, and You leave in worse condition because their opinion matters, because you're serving them instead of serving God, right? So serving God is the most important thing. And the only way we can do all of these for God is through Holy Spirit, having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? That's the only way. That's the only way. I hope that you enjoyed the message today, and I hope that you gave your heart to Jesus Christ. And if you're here and you have not, and you would like to right now, all you have to do is ask for forgiveness of your sins and receive Jesus into your heart as Lord and Savior, and you are saved and set apart. That's all it is. And I want you to email me. I want you to email me so I can be praying with you, that I can be believing with you, that we can equip you, that we can stay in contact with you, because I want to welcome you to the family. And while you're here watching right now, make sure you check us out at Peak Worship, and make sure you get involved with all of our social medias. That means you like us, you follow us, check everything out about us so you can get plugged in. Amen. And we will see you next time.